2 minutes. Give me 2 minutes to make sure that everybody that needs to come in gets in. That everybody that has software problems, has whatever problems, they're able to get in and we're able to get forward in a handful of minutes. Guys, welcome to 2016. Welcome to the webinar. Let's get this thing going and let's have some fun today. You know, of course it's going to be educational. You know, just like Sesame Street, it's going to be fun, but it's going to be educational. So let's have some fun today and really let's make something happen. Let's go do something special. So Francisco, how you doing? Evo, what's going on? Sandra Mullen from Wyoming. How you doing? Tell your wife I said hello. Darren, how you doing? Ben Arsenal, a pleasure to see you. What's going on? Bob Baer, my friend. Guys, Bob Baer is my man. I met him when I was in Seattle. He is one of my good friends, one of my good students. I love this guy. He's got the best Canadian accent you've ever heard. You know, a lot of times you talk to a Canadian person and you think, man, that's a really nice guy. And a lot of Canadian people have like southern accents almost. And Bob Baer is one of those people. He's a gentleman. He's a scholar. He's got the craziest accent ever. He is awesome. Britt, how you doing? What's going on? Yes, guys, I am on the road still. I am back from Hawaii. I was in Hawaii and Bali for the last, I don't even know how long, but I'm back in the United States. But the problem was I came back to the United States, and I read the weather reports, and it was so cold, and so I didn't want to go home, and so I went to Florida. I got my car, my Felicia. For you guys that don't know my car, I got this awesome, like, bright blue car, and we call her Felicia. So I picked her up, and then I drove to Charleston. Charleston is awesome, guys. For those of you guys that are single, and if you are a trader, you're probably going to be single. Traders are single. Traders are miserable. Traders are lonely. That's because you got to sit in front of a computer all day. But as a trader, I went to Charleston. It is the city of love, my friends. It really is. So I've been here the last, I don't even know, 3 weeks. And then, you know what? I'll figure out where I'm going to go next. I think I got everybody in. So, guys, welcome. For those of you guys that don't know me, my name is Kunal Desai. I am the president, the CEO, the head trader, the janitor of Bulls on Wall Street. That's my company. You guys find me on Instagram, Periscope, wherever it might be. I wanted to talk to you guys about today and do a webinar because what I've noticed in the last couple months is something that's really interesting and something that's changed. And that is that, you know, since 2008, and that's when I opened Bulls on Wall Street, I was a young man there. I had hair. I had muscles. I had abs. Well, okay, I lied. I didn't have any abs. But Indian people can't get abs. It's just a genetic thing. You know, we're eating rice and cookies all day. But I had hair, and I had youth. And that was the last time that we had this type of market structure. And we've had a blips along the way in the last 8 years. But, you know, we've seen it over the last few months. Something had been changing in the market. Something had been changing in the markets in October, November, December. We started to really, really see it, and it reared its ugly head. And come January, it is just a straight-on bear market. I've seen it before. I can tell what it is, and it's there. And so I want to take some time and talk to you guys not only about just hitting your goals in 2016, which is huge, but also how to survive and profit in this crazy market that we're going to see this year. You know, I don't know. Listen, I'm not a prediction person. I'm not a fortune teller. So I don't know what's going to happen. the whole year. What I can tell you is in the last 3 months, we have started to see a change in market structure that could permeate throughout the year. What we are seeing, and there are facts and pieces of evidence throughout the world beyond the United States, that things are nasty. Things are nasty. Whether you are in China, you look at Brazil, it's in the toilet. I mean, everywhere you go, there are signs that say something odd is happening. So the tactics that you guys grew up with, because most of you guys are young people, you haven't been trading that long. The tactics and techniques that you have grown up with, that you have become accustomed to, they're going to change. The strategies that we use are going to change. But just because there is a bear market or there's bear market type trading doesn't mean that your goals go down the gutter, okay? I always tell my students this, I go, it doesn't matter what the markets do, because every year you're going to get better. So in 2008, the market was nasty. That was 8 years ago for me. Every year, I double as a trader. I get better as a trader. I focus on what I need to do and then what is happening and what's working, and I get better. And so I am now two times. For you mathematicians out there, what's 2 to the 8th power? I am 100 times better trader now than I was in 2018, because every year I grow. And so you guys, even though it's going to be a nasty year, it doesn't mean you can just chalk it up to say, hey, it was a bear market. I couldn't make any money. I lost all my money. I lost my job. I lost everything. That doesn't work, because there are things that you can do to go out and make money. And we're going to talk about it and really dive into it, because it's important. The structure of what happens in a bear market, and bear market, even if it's not a bear market and doesn't just tank 50%, guess what? If the market takes 25% or 30%, people are going to feel it. You're going to see job losses. You're going to see weird stuff happen in the economy, and you've got to go fend for yourself. You know, my dad has seen it. You know, I talk to my dad all the time, and I've lived with my dad all these years, and if you ever see me traveling and stuff, my parents are always with me, and my dad will tell you, like, he's like, man, I've lost my whole 401k like 4 different times. I lost it in the bear market of 79. I lost it in the bear market of 88. And, you know, it's always happened like that, and he's like, and now he's like 62 years old. He's like, I ain't got any money. When you go through like 6 bear markets and you lose it all every time, you get nothing left. You know, he's like, I got like $100,000 left. You know, he's like, it's a good thing I got a cool son. But, you know, we don't want to get into that point. So it has been a crazy year. You know, it's been a crazy year. If you're looking at the markets, they say that the start of the market has been the worst it's been in a long time. And so, you guys, let's get rid of all these squiggly lines here real quick before we add them back. But this start to the market since January, right, has been the worst that anybody has seen of living people in their lifetime, okay? And they say that the beginning of the market is like a tell for what's going to happen in the rest of the year, okay? And throughout the years, you know, when I would see something like this, I would, and you know, I used to have a job like everybody else. And I still have a job, you know, I run Bulls and whatever, but I used to have a job, like a desk job where I sat in a cubicle. It was gray, it was very dark. I had this boss that always kind of peered over my head and always made comments on the fact that I was losing my hair. And, you know, I had a job like that, but guess what? When you're looking and you see this, know that this is potentially what could happen the rest of the year, okay? And so when you see that, You've got to start planning ahead. This is one of the worst starts that the market's ever seen. Now, does it mean that the market's going to just tank 50%? No. But there's signs there that say, hey, it could. And so we need to prepare for it. So when you see this type of action, what happens is we got to change our tactics a little bit. And so that's what we're going to do. And I've been doing it every single day and actually making some decent money. And so we want to really dig into that. So there's different things that happen in the market, okay? And so right now, I want you guys to focus on traps, okay? This is what will happen in bear market 2016, traps, okay? The things that you know about stocks, okay? The things that you've been doing the last 8 years, they're not going to work. You're going to have to switch them around. They're called bull traps, and they've been happening a lot. And so, like, for like when I do my 60-day boot camp, okay, we talk about flags all the time. We love flags. We love flat top breakouts. It is one of my favorite patterns in a bull market, okay? And so what happens is when you see this pattern, if you're in a bull market, okay, when you see this pattern, it is one of the most bullish patterns you can see. When you have multiple tests at a level, what happens is that level gets weaker, okay? Stocks are about supply and demand. So when you have a level here that keeps getting tested over and over, you're tapped. It is like beating down a door, okay? It's like beating down a door. You're hitting it, and you are hitting it, and you are hitting it. And at some point, guess what happens? That door breaks, because every time you hit the door, it gets weaker. That's what happens when you see this pattern in a bull market. It's beautiful. It is a beautiful pattern, and when you see it in a bull market, you will make so much money. I mean, literally, you'll make so much money. We've seen it before, like when Amazon broke over $300, $300, $400, whatever it is. When it broke over $450, and when it broke, right? We've seen these flat top patterns before. And guess what? They're amazing. But what happens is when the structure of the market changes, your trades have to change. So there are four cycles in a market, guys. Now write this down. I want you to really think about this. Four cycles in a market. Every cycle requires you to trade in a little bit different manner. What works in one market doesn't always work in another market. So what we have seen the last X amount of years, minus a few blips, is a bull market. So that's what we call a run-up phase, okay? A run-up phase. So run-up phase is your regular bull market where the market is flying. The market is flying and everything is going up, and every single dip in the market gets bought up. You know, that's what we've seen for really just a long, long time. So if you're looking at the market, like, you see this? This is from 2012. Every dip in the market, what happens? It gets bought. It gets bought, right? Every dip for years and years and years in the general market gets bought, okay? In 2015, we started to see a little bit of change in character. The market itself started to sit in standstill a little bit. So the run-up phase ended, and we started moving more towards a distribution phase, okay? The distribution phase in the market is the toughest market to trade. So if you were in 2015 and you were thinking, man, this market was freaking tough, well, that is the case, because the distribution market is the toughest market to trade. A distribution market is a market that just stays flat. But During that time, the volume pattern of stocks shifts. You'll start to see not that many stocks go up. You'll start to see some real selling into stocks, and things will start to change. The structure of the market will start to change. And if you look at 2015, even though the market was flat, if you take out Amazon, you take out Facebook, which is a nice little trender all year too. You take out Google, nice move. You know, it went from the 500s to 800s, up a lot. When you take out Netflix, these are like your, they call them FANG stocks, F-A-N-G. You take out these kind of stocks, the rest of the market, every single stock was down 20%, 30%. 2015, even though the market was flat, the signs were already there, minus a handful of stocks, that the market was donezo. That's why only the most quickest and astute of traders made money in 2015. People like yours truly. I don't want to pat any hands on my back or pat any hands on my neck or whatever they call it. But it was a very, very special year. So that's called your distribution market, where the market's at highs, but stocks start to go down. When you start to see the distribution market, you start changing the parameters of what you do. You start not buying the breakouts, not starting to load up on those type of stocks because most stocks are going down. So you change your tactics. And then once that distribution market ends and the next year comes and you start to run down, that's your rundown market. That's your bear market type trading. This is the scary stuff. When the news in the world sucks, the news about the economy starts to change, there's fear in the air, and then the market starts to crater, and all your favorite stocks do too. And so during that phase, those bullish patterns that you see, that you've been taught to love, they all fail. They're called bull traps. And so you can't trust them. So you see something like this, that's a bull trap. It's going to die. Okay? It's a shorting opportunity. And the market is very, very funny because what they'll do is they'll let it break out just to sucker up enough people to buy it so then it can reverse. And then you get the tankola. And so you've got to be really, really aware of these type of things. You can't trust this pattern. In 2016, it's going to be more about mean reversion. Mean reversion means that stocks that are down a lot, they revert back to their mean, or stocks that are up a lot revert back to their mean. That's usually what happens in this type of bear market. But this type of bull trap, so I teach my students all this time, when we see this stock, like a trending stock like this, and you see a breakout like this, what do you think? You see a stock consolidating like this and breaks out, that gap is usually very bullish. In a bull market, guys, write this down, a gap is bullish. In a bear market, when you get a gap like that, it's usually an exhaustion gap, meaning that that is usually the spot where everything ends. Okay, it's the last gasp. They call it an exhaustion gap. Okay, it suckers in the people, then the smart money sells into it, and the stock reverses. So this is what, these are some of the trades that we've been doing, is saying, hey, the stocks that we would buy in a bull market, the stocks that we love in a bull market, the setups that we trade in a bull market, we just do the complete opposite. This setup is called a breakaway gap, okay? Breakaway gap. It's called a breakaway gap. In a bull market, the breakaway gap is my favorite setup. It is a setup that can run for months and months and months. A breakaway gap can often be the catalyst that can send a stock on for a long time. But when you see a breakaway gap in a bear market scenario, that gap is going to fail. And so what happens is when you see it, we take it the other way. Remember what I was talking about, mean reversion. We go counter trend and we short the S word out of it. Mary Beth is watching. She asked me not to swear anymore. So we short the S word out of it. Sucks. Crap. No, I'm just kidding. We short it because we know the trap is there. Because think about this and just the psychology of it. The market structure is changing. The easy money is over. The fun times are over. Okay? And you're down on a stock and it's dying and you're in the bear market. You may be a little bit stubborn to sell it because you don't want to sell it at a loss, right? You don't want to sell what's down so much. But you have these other stocks that are up a lot, FSLR, Amazon, whatever. And you're thinking, man, I can relieve some of my pain and just sell these things because they're up a lot and take my profits. And so what you see is those stocks gap up or they break out and they die because that's the easiest sell. Even though, it's, you know, that's the easiest sell is to right, sell something that you're making money on. And then you kind of, most people who are never smart, they'll double down on their losers. They'll take the money and use it for something else. But that's what they sell first. So when you see these things, you know, this is another stock that we shorted the crap out of. When it finally gapped up out of resistance, right, that gap will start to fill. Right, that's your bull trap. You see this gap, and by the way, if you see this type of gap in bull markets or bull market trading, it is a bullish sign. So don't think like, you know, something gaps, you short it. That's not the case, guys. That's not the case. In bull markets, when you see that gap, I'm usually wanting to long that. I usually want to long that. So like, and that's one of my go-to setups. You know, like, when I see a gap like this in a bull market, stock's sitting here and it gaps up, and then it pulls back. This is what we call a breakout pullback setup. This is what I do in my IRAs, you know, where I'm not day trading, but I want to hold something for a long time. I let a stock gap up, and then after the gap up day, once it comes back and forms a pattern and gets back close to the bottom of the breakout bar, I long it. When it comes out of the pattern, and then I can swing trade it for the breakout. So I love that pattern. I love gaps. To me, that's a sign of bullishness. That's a sign of bullishness. Well, what happens is in this type of market, what people start to sell, what they're up a lot of. What's up a lot can go down the most. And so that's like the type of action that you're seeing in like an Amazon or Netflix or something like that. The stock that's up a lot can come down just as much. And so you got to change your tactics. Those are your bull traps, okay? So some of the things besides just on your daily charts taking these bad boys down is using the proper tactics to short them when you actually see the setups intraday, okay? So, for example, like an Amazon. So once this starts to happen, okay? Once the rollover starts to happen, you gotta get in on this thing. You gotta get in on this thing, okay? And so, you need to short it. And when you're a day trader, you need intraday setups to start to align. So write this down. In bull markets, gap ups are awesome. And then you can play them to the upside on an intraday basis. In bear markets, the gap downs are a sign of bearishness. And you can actually use proper intraday setups on the gap down to play them to the downside. And so you got to really, really think about it in those manners. And so, like, if you see something like an Amazon or something, when it starts to break down, this is what we call an opening range breakdown, okay? This is what we call, oh, this is Netflix. Sorry. This is what we call an opening range breakdown. So, an opening range breakdown is a pattern that we use at the open, okay? For those of you guys that are brand new, you don't understand what the fuck I'm talking about, you don't understand really any of this, email me, canal, K-U-N-A-L, at B-U-L-L-S-O-N.W-S. I'll send you some beginner classes. We do these boot camps that start people from dead beginning. This will be more for people that understand kind of the lingo of this. You get a gap down, it is bullish. You know, and you can play the ORBs to the gap down. Meaning, an ORB is, hold on. So an ORB is essentially, anytime you get a gap down in a stock that should roll over, remember trading is about aligning on multiple time frames. You use your daily charts for a big picture. Use your daily charts for a big picture of what should happen on a stock on a big picture. This Amazon's going to roll over. It's a bull trap. Then you use your intraday charts to align what you see on the big picture. So use your intraday charts for your proper entries and exits based on your overall thesis for the big picture. For a lot of the new traders that I see, some of my best students that I get when they're new, really sharp guys, one of the mistakes they always make is they look at an intraday chart and they think, I'm going to do X, Y, or Z on it. And then they say, oh my gosh, Canal, it didn't work. What do I do? I'm a bad trader. My wife's going to kill me for wasting my savings. And I say, well, it was a good trade on your intraday. But guess what? You had no edge because what you thought was going to happen on the intraday wasn't really going to happen. And he'd say, well, I saw a flag. And I said, well, your flag doesn't mean shit. And he says, why? I was looking at that intraday chart and I saw the flag. I love flags. Everybody loves flags. All new traders, they love flags. They think flags are what makes them money. Flags are not what make you money. What makes you money is understanding on a big picture basis what a stock should do. And then using your smaller term time frames to align it and get in at the right time at the right place. So your big picture is what gives you the thesis. I believe Canal Desai, Amazon should do this. It's going to roll over, and it's going to come down to $530. It's going to drop hundreds of dollars. Okay, so I have a big picture thesis of what should happen. Now I use a smaller term time frame to align it on my big picture thesis to get the proper entries. And so when you see it in a bear market, when you see a gap down and a stock should be rolling over, that gap down is a sign of wonderfulness. You can trade that. And so we call this an ORB. When you get a stock that gaps down, that should be rolling over big time. When you get three candles on a 5-minute chart that go sideways, Okay, this is a trade for the open only. Okay, if you did a three candle trade middle of the day, you will lose 99.9% of the time. At the open is about quick moves. They last for a half an hour, maybe an hour max. Okay, so you have to have quick patterns. Middle of the day is about retracement. You'll have longer patterns, and so you need longer setups. And then end of day, the same thing. But the open is just about the quick hitters. So at the open, if you see a stop gap down and you think it's supposed to be going down on the daily chart, right? It's a bull trap, like I showed you. You wait for three candles on a five-minute chart. When it goes sideways and it takes out those lows, now you've got yourself very, very nice short setup. And I know what you're thinking. So like a stock like Amazon goes from 650 and it's going down to 620. You're thinking, oh my gosh, well, I can't afford a $600 stock. I should think the same thing. Okay? Think about this. I've got in my hedge fund, we have 172 traders, students of mine, that have taken my boot camp and they trade inside my hedge fund. 172. One of my biggest winners for the last couple days, okay, he literally was trading 40 shares of Amazon at one time. Why? Well, he's got a very small account, a $2,000 type of account. But he recognizes, well, even if you're at 25, 50 shares and the stock drops $20, $30 because it's got range, you can make a lot of money. You can make a lot of money. You want the stocks to have the big range. In a bear market, small cap stocks, penny stocks are bullshit. They have no range. They have no volume. There's no money to be made. You got to go back to trading regular stocks because they're the ones that are going to have the range. So you can actually make – I'd rather have 10 shares of a stock that moves 40, 50 bucks than have, right, 1,000 shares of a stock that moves 5 cents. And you're trying to capture, like, the perfect 5 cents you can get all of it. There's no range for you to capture. Right? There's nothing you can do. So you want to be playing these bigger stocks because they're going to have more range. So think about these opening range breakdowns because that will give you in a trade at the open. 90% of the money I make is at the open in the first 30 minutes. That's how it always has been. Not because open is the easiest. I'm a morning person. And if you can match the setups you trade with the time you like to trade, you can make money. So there's three types of trading periods in the day. You have the open. The open is about price discovery. Okay? The open is where you get the big, big spikes. The open is where you get the big spikes, where you get that nastiness at the open the first 30 minutes. The middle of the day is where a stock starts to retrace, where a stock starts to go and either consolidate, go sideways, or it starts to creep up and retrace a little bit and relieve its tension. And then end of the day, a stock will make its move, okay? And so that's really, really important when you're thinking about stocks because your time of days. So there's different tactics for bull markets and bear markets, but there's also different tactics that you take from the open, which is the first hour of the day, the middle of the day, which is from 11 o'clock a.m. Eastern time to 2 p.m., and then from 2 p.m. to 4, totally different tactics. So like we were trading Amazon the other day. So at the open, you take this opening range breakdown. So this is yesterday, okay? So you take this opening range breakdown. Well, the opening range breakdown is just meant for the first hour. So guess what you have to do, right? You get out of it. As a day trader, you got to get out of the stock and recognize when you get these type of big flushes where you get $10, $15 quickly, you've got to take your gains. And then the rest of the day, the middle of the day, is about retracement or consolidation. So a stock will go sideways. And then end of the day, you tend to pick a direction. You tend to pick a direction, and that's when you can either break to the upside or break to the downside. You've got to have your levels messed up. So the setups you trade at the open, the close, and the middle are a little bit different. Just like the setups that you trade at a bull market are the opposite of what you would do in a bear market. Trading is a bizarre world, and where a lot of people make mistakes is they take what they read in a book, or they take what they read in some guy's chat room or DVD or whatever it might be, and they say, this is the blanket rule for everything. But that's not the case. The rules and the setups change depending on the market conditions, but also the time of the day. And so if you're a trader that you know what you've been doing, but you just failed, and you know what you've been reading, but it's been failing you, and you know that you've been working hard and that you know your stuff, but it's still not clicking and showing up in your profits, there's a good shot that what you're doing is not matching up with what the market is showing. What the market does and your trade setups have to mesh together. And so that's going to be really, really important. So one of the things that's been working in this market, so let me tell you this for in this historically, and this is what I teach in my classes. You know, I have 60-day boot camp. You know, we teach this in our classes, and this is a staple. This is a staple of what we do. A gap in a stock, a gap to the upside. Most people, they see a gap in a stock. Stock's at $100, and it gaps up to $5. They think that's bearish because they're like, oh, man, I wish I could have got it at $5 or $100. But in a bull market, the gap is actually very bullish. It's a positive sign. I love gaps because it tells me the direction that a stock could go the rest of the day. So in a bull market, if a stock gaps up like that, meaning that it's at 100, 610, and it gaps up to 620, to me that's a bullish sign, and it could mean the stock's going to go to 640, 650, 660 in a bull market. In a bear market, when the market itself is due to flush, when you see that gap, what happens is the gap comes back and fills. You have to go counter trend. That all strength will be sold off. All strength will be given up. That when you see the green, it's going to go red. When you think you got something, you got nothing. That's what happens in bear markets. It gets you excited, pulls it out from underneath you. So when you see the gap, let me tell you this. All the years I've traded, I love gaps. It's a big part of what we teach in our boot camp. We see the gap, and it's a bull market, and we use certain tactics to play the gap so we can get in. I love the gap. But in a bear market, you see that gap, and you got to always match it with what's supposed to happen on the big picture of the market. Is the market going down, market going up? Guess what? You gotta look for spots where the gap can fade. If the gap fades and it starts to break down, see, look at this. So this is what we call ORB, okay? ORB, just like we saw on Amazon the other day, right? ORB is what we were talking about. So this is ORB to the downside. We love ORBs. Let me tell you this. I love me some ORB. It's a gap down, three candles sideways on a five-minute chart. When you break loose, go get them. Go get them, right? I love the ORB, okay? To the downside in a bear market. When you see the ORB to the upside. In a bear market, don't do it. Don't do it, because what happens is it is going to crack all up. It's going to crack and it's going to get nasty. It's going to get nasty. And you got to remember that. So you see that ORB, just know it ain't going to work. Oh, no, it ain't going to work. You got to go. It's going to sucker you in. See these people right here? These people right here, they're the suckers. They don't know any better, though, so pray for them. Feel for them, and then point them to this webinar. Because guess what? That ORB ain't going to work. It ain't going to work. It ain't going to work. It ain't going to work. It's going to go to the downside. We short, meaning we bet on stocks to go down when we see this setup. Okay? Those gaps, they're gifts for us in bear markets. Because say a stock's at 600, it gaps at 640. Well, guess what? It just gave us $40 of free money, baby. It just gave us free money. And so that, we want to see those gaps. We want to take those gaps down. All right? We want to take those gaps down and short them to the downside, guys. It's so huge. It means so much to do it. And you can see, like, it'll do it. You think you can't do it multiple days in a row. Well, guess what? It can be happening every day. For a very long time. You know, we did the same plan Amazon literally for days upon days. Like, I'd wake up, you know, I pray a lot. But I mostly pray to the stock guys. And when I pray in a bear market, what I pray for is the gap up. I want to see that morning shrimp. Because in a bull market, traders trade up, they chase up the morning shrimp, and it actually pays them. And traders, they have a tough time adapting. As a trader, guys, I want to tell you, I'm not the smartest trader. You could tell. I mean, look at me. I mean, I look like, right, your plumber. I'm not the smartest of guys. What I am good at, I think, is recognizing my weaknesses. But most importantly, I think, like, what I do good is adapting. And knowing that what I do now won't always be what I'm going to do later. You know what I mean? And so being flexible and understanding the evidence of not like, hey, this is my ego or this is just what I do, but being flexible and really thinking about like, hey, this is what's going to work, right? This is what is working and I've got to do it. And so in bull markets, and I've always told my students this, that gap is powerful and we want to play to the upside. And so you have that ingrained in your head. And so that's what you want to do when you see the gap, because you have a routine. You've done it for 8 years, right? Or 7 years or 5 years. Most of my students are 4 or 5 years, 4 or 5 years in the making. So they have a habit. And then what they have to do is they got to change. They got to change. And so now it's like, hey, we see the gap up, and it's like, hey, we got to short it. You know, we got to be able to change so that we can make the profits. And so now when we see it, we're going counter trend so that we can play a little bit of that juice. The second part. So let me just give you a little bit of juice on what we're doing. Most of the money that we're making, okay, most of the money that we make is really in the first, and it's always been that way, in the first 30 minutes of the day, first hour of the day, okay? And the reason of that is that in this type of market, you get a huge amount of volatility right at the open, and then things kind of die down the rest of the day. That's kind of what's been going down. So we take our trades, we make them quick, and then we get out. And then later in the day, we may come back and ride the day-long plays. Because remember that the middle of the day is about what? It's about consolidation, or retracement. So it's dead money. Consolidation or retracement is literally dead money. I mean, there's not as much to do. The open is volatile. The end of the day is volatile. The middle of the day, not as much going on. And I give back money all the time. You know, many people do. I mean, it's not as easy because what are you going to do all? Some days you sit there and you think, like, well, what am I going to do all day? So you sit at the computer. But the middle of the day is usually dead money. I can say that for most of my career, like when I left for to go to the gym in the middle of the day, or if I left to go do just some work in the middle of the day, or go visit somebody, or have some lunch with some friends, guess what? That's when I usually lose money. You know, I've had like some bad days. You know, since December 1st, I've had two losing days, and both losing days were because I made a few thousand bucks at the open, and then I stayed, and I just sat there in the middle of the day where there's no range, and I grinded it out, and all those small losses started to add up to bigger losses because you just start over-trading. So in this type of market right now, you're not getting that type of movement. You're not getting that type of movement in the middle of the day. So you got to go and take a chill pill and then come back, and then you'll get some action. And that's huge. So let's talk about another play that I do a lot at the open. And this is called the green to red. I love the green to red play. For those of you guys that are my students that have been with me for a while, they know we trade a lot of red to greens. We've had a bull market for a long time, so we trade red to greens. And a red to green is essentially a play where a stock was up a lot the previous day. It could be up 10%, 20%, 30%. And the next day, it opens up weak. It opens up a little bit weak. And I want really light open. I don't want it to open down like 10% or open weak 20%. I want it to open up really weak. Just minus 0.5% or 1%. It opens up weak for a hot second. So it's red on the day. And then it goes green, meaning it's up for the day. So as soon as it crosses over where it's down 20 cents or 10 cents, and now it's up, all of a sudden you get this explosion. And the same thing happens in the bear market. Okay? A stock that was nasty the day before. Okay? What happens is if it faded off the day before, what happens is the next day, so like this is Amazon. So see how it gapped up the previous day? So look, it's at 598. It got all the way to 626, so it had like a decent run in it, okay? And it gapped up, and then it just faded off the whole day. So it was weak the previous day. So then what happens the next day, though, if it opens up green, what happens is when a stock opens up green, meaning it's up for the day. See right here? It was just only up like a buck. But when a stock opens up green and it's up for the day, what happens with people is they think, oh, my gosh, this could be the day that Amazon gets all the way back, right? Because you're thinking this is the hottest stock in the world. And it's going to get back. So it opens up green, and you're thinking, wow, this stock has fallen $100. It should go all the way back. And so it opens up green, and you think that's the beginning of it. Oh, my gosh, I got to get in this thing. It could go up $100. It's down so much. And so it opens up green, and it gets just enough people excited to buy it. And so you're buying it. And then it doesn't hold. So it stalls out at 620. And then at, this would be about 618, it goes red. Meaning it's down for the day. So imagine this. And this is psychologically. You know, you buy a stock because you think it's going to bounce a lot. And it's green on the day. And you think today's the bounce day. And then immediately it goes red, meaning you're down. You're down money, but the stock is also down for the day. What's your natural reaction? Oh my gosh, it's going to tank like it did the day before. Or like how it was doing the last 4 or 5 days, right? This stock used to be $700. Maybe now it's going to go to $500 like it should be. I was wrong. So you sell. So all those people, they sell. And then the people like us come in and we short, right? So stock goes from green to red, meaning literally it's up a dollar or 50 cents, and then it's down 1 penny. That means it goes red. When it's down 1 penny, it's red on the day. At that moment, you're taking it short, knowing that everybody's going to sell. The shorters are going to come in. Now you get the flush, right? And in this type of market where there's a lot of volatility, in this market right now, there's a lot of volatility. You're getting huge ranges on stocks. And so you hit it when it goes red. You could be making $10 on a stock, whether it was Netflix or Amazon or whatever, within 20, 30 minutes. You know, and so that green to red is huge. That can start off a big, big push. And, you know, we just did that again today. You know, like today. So I was off. My game was a little bit off today. But I'm about $6,000 today. $6,000. And, you know, one of my big, big winners for today. So I made $1,800 on Amazon. I made $1,100 on Netflix today. And it was the same type of move in that. Oh, wrong song. Check this out. And this is the type of stuff that you get in this type of market. So look at this. So this stock had a tankola. Had a tankola the previous day. It was nasty. By the way, Amazon did an opening range breakout. And we hit this thing. I don't want to talk about it right now. I'm a little bit butthurt by the fact that I had 1,000 shares short of this thing. We did the opening range breakdown because it gapped down. I had 1,000 shares short of this thing, like right here at 113.50. And I covered it like 111. This sucker got down all the way. Shame upon my house of Desai, right? Shame upon my house. I was done trading by 10:30 yesterday, so I don't hold myself too responsible for missing some of the moves, but, right, I mean, I should have worked the whole day. You know, like, what did I have to do yesterday except watch Netflix and eat Lebanese food? Neither one of them treated me well. So, nasty, right? So I had a nasty fall. So today, at the open, what I'm looking for is a little bit of green, okay? If it has a light open where it goes green for a little bit, okay? What I'm watching for is if that green doesn't hold and it goes red, I'm going to short it right away. So I shorted 1,000 shares at 106.50. And literally, and remember, the open is about quick trades. And literally in 6 to 7 minutes, I was already down to 101. Okay, so I only made $1,000 on this. I covered a little too early. But look, there's $5,000 in potential profits on it. I mismanaged the trade a little bit. I could have extracted probably a little bit more profit. But that's what we want to see at that open is those quick flushes. That's what you get. The open is about the quick flush. And then let the middle of the day do what it's going to do. Okay, but that's the green to red. In a bear market, your green to red is one of the most powerful tools that you can do. And, you know, one of the things I did today was the same thing. So if you look here, I made $1,800 on Amazon. I made $1,800 on Amazon, and it was the same type of setup. It wasn't rocket science, guys. You know, I'm Indian, but it doesn't mean I know a lot about rocket science, right? Same type of deal. So, stock goes green for a hot second. It gets all the way to 586. See that? And then boom, gap doesn't hold, and it goes red. Once it goes red, I take this thing short. So I took Amazon short like 400 shares at 582. As soon as it went red, what is 583, 582, whatever. And then it was just about playing that flush. Now, the market did rebound a little bit later. And once oil prices started going up, the market rebounded. But the open is about that quick setup. And these stocks have been giving us that every day. You know, you look at something like, this was actually one of my biggest trades of the year. You know, Amazon had this huge flush the day before. See this thing? Nasty, right? So the next day, what did it do? It gapped up. See this? So, you know, getting all the way down to like 624, gapped up to about 650. And as soon as that, it doesn't hold, it starts to reverse, right? We're taking this thing short, and literally, so this is 5-minute candles, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. 40 minutes later, it's already dropped $20, right? So even if you had 10 shares of it, you would make $200. In this market right now, the volatility is so huge that you can make $20, $30 or $5 or $10, whatever, depending on the stock, in seconds. But you got to have the right tactics to play. Very rarely, though, in any of these stocks have I made money middle of the day. So look at the middle of the day on some of these things. Just sit around, right? Look at the middle of the day on this day. Like, is there any real pattern you can play? No. There's nothing. You know, look at the middle of the day on this stuff. Choppy. Then later in the day, end of day, it flushes, right? You're not going to get necessarily always the best plays middle of the day. You just kind of sit around. It's the open and then the close that gives you the juice. Middle of the day tends to be a little bit nasty. Not much going on. And I find, me personally, one of the biggest things I do in this type of market is to stay away from overtrading, okay? Meaning being selective. There's been days in the last 6 weeks where I've had good days, but I just traded too much. And when you trade too much in a bad market, what happens is you're giving yourselves more time to make a mistake, okay? In trading, it's all about minimizing mistakes. And so the more you trade, the more you're exposing yourself to that one big mental mistake where you get a little bit stubborn or you hold a little bit something too long, and then your profits are wiped out. You know, me and Zaman is my partner and one of my mentors and probably like the best trader I know. And it's like we never lose. Me and him together, we're like, we never lose. Anytime we ever lose, it'd be like once every 2 weeks or once a month or whatever it might be. When we lose, it always comes from the same thing. We make trades when we're not supposed to make trades. We overtrade when we need to just relax and we don't see anything. You know, you let the game come to you, right? And we don't see anything, and we're both veterans between me and him, right? We got 30 years of market experience, hundreds of thousands of trades. So we know when it's dead. But then at those times where it's dead, you kind of think you can sneak one in. You think you can sneak one in and maybe eat one out. But it never works like that, right? That overtrading always causes us the losses. And so, you know, that's really, really important to just recognize time of day and what's going on, because it will cause you guys the losses, especially when you're a newer trader. Let me tell you, a newer trader has much less leeway to make mistakes than a more experienced trader. And the reason is just simply capital, right? So, like, if I lost $20,000 tomorrow, and I'm not saying I'd ever take it that far, but I'm just saying, if I lost $20,000 tomorrow, it'd be devastating. I'd be devastated. On a personal level, a professional level, an emotional level, and definitely a physical level, I would just be devastated. But I'd come back, right? When you're a newer trader and you have less capital, you can't overtrade because you can't expose yourself to that one mistake that's going to nail you, right? You don't want to get to that point. And so being very selective on your trades is going to be super, super helpful when you're going about things. I don't know why. Mary Beth put this here. Oh my gosh. Me when I was younger, I wish for her. Oh, I love Selena Gomez. I really do like Selena Gomez. I can't believe she did this. Sorry, Mary Beth makes all my slides, and she has got me today. I do not drive a Hyundai. Man, I'm going to get her back. I don't even know what all this is. Twitch alert. I don't even know what this is. I don't know what any of this is, but it's very funny. But let's talk about some of the other stuff. So I want you to think about these ORBs and the green to reds, okay? Or those are kind of two setups that I use a lot, okay? We're going to talk about another one in a hot second, but let me just tell you something. And this is actually one of my favorite plays. This is a shorting at resistance, okay? Shorting at resistance. So, UVXY. I made 3,000 bucks in UVXY today. I made probably 3,000 bucks. I made like 8 or 10,000 the other day. Trading this thing. Hold on, little mama. Hold on, little mama. I've been chilling this thing every day, all right, on this UVXY. And so when the market goes down, UVXY is a volatility ETF. So when the market goes down, UVXY goes up quite a bit, okay? And so when the market's going down, it means there's more fear in the world, and you can play this UVXY to the upside. So, you know, you can literally play this thing to the upside a lot. Remember how we were talking about opening range breakdowns, meaning a stock gaps down because it's weak, and then it follows through. Well, UVXY is the anti-reverse of the market. So if the market's gapping down or the market's weak, UVXY is going to gap up. And so in that case, you could play like the old rules, where the gap up is very bullish, and then you can play it when it starts to break levels of resistance. You can start playing it to the upside and really, really get some good profits going, because this thing fucking moves. Mary Beth asked me not to swear today. I'm sorry. I get really excited, and I throw those F-bombs out. It is a Midwest thing. I come from a very blue-collar family. I just swear a lot. But I won't do it again. So, you know, you can play this thing to the upside. So when the market's tanking, this thing will go up. This thing will go up. Now, when the market starts to run, UVXY will go down. So I want you to show you this. This is what we call a VWAP trade, a VWAP fake. So VWAP stands for volume weighted average price. So it's like the line in the sand on a stock, meaning that when a stock is above the VWAP, it means the average person's in the money. And when a stock is below the VWAP, it means the average person is down on their money. But what it means in just chart terms is that, you know, if a stock tanks and you roll up into your VWAP, that can be a potential area where you can take a trade back to the downside. And so, you know, I missed this whole run. You know, UVXY is at $47. It got down to $39. $8. I miss it. And this is, I hate missing these things. This is like $8 in like 30 minutes, right? Who wants to miss that? But always know this, guys, and never chase stocks. You never chase a short. You never chase a long. You chase, you die. You chase, you will always lose. You chase, you will never make money in the stock market. Chasers end up blowing up their accounts. I have a rule. I never chase more than 3 or 4 green candles to the upside. I never chase more than 3 or 4 green candles to the downside. Because stocks will always come back. You know that if you get a 5 or 6 red candles, you're probably going to start to retrace back to the upside. There will be another play for you. Guys, in the markets, if you miss something, there will always be another play. There will always be something else. The markets are an endless opportunity-generating mechanism. They always have opportunities. Never should you feel like if you don't take this trade once right now, you will not make any money. There will be an opportunity within 15 to 20 minutes. Ingrain it into your head. If you miss something, there will be an opportunity in 15 to 20 minutes. The market is an opportunity-generating mechanism. It took me so many years to get that in my head. I saw something moving, I had to have it. I had to have it because I was afraid I would miss it. But that's not the case, because when I had to have it and I was afraid that I would miss it, I always lost. Because what happens is when you are the last one to buy, when you chase it up, when you chase the unicorns, guess what happens? The stock comes back down and you sell it and you're stuck. It always is the case. You chase, you die. You chase, you're chasing unicorns. But if you wait, and I promise you, you wait 15, 20 minutes, it will come back. And that's the case. I always think about this in the middle of the day. If it comes back, middle of the day, the VWAP is one of the best indicators, the best pieces of line in the sand that you can count on. So after a big move, either way, up or down, if you retrace back to the VWAP and it holds, it holds, you will get yourself a very, very good opportunity to get in a stock in the middle of the day. And so when I see a flush like this, that tells me that the market is taking off. And then if it starts to retrace back into that VWAP, now I have myself not only a low-risk entry, but also a high-probability entry. And that's huge, right? As traders, we want to always focus on probability, high-low, preferably high, and then risk, right? High-low again, preferably low. And so that midday thrust after a flush into that VWAP is, number one, a high-probability setup, but also very low risk because you have a line in the sand. that V we have, right? And so, you know, like today, you know, we're shorting into resistance. I'm not trying to chase this thing down. But as it starts to retrace into that VWAP, and all I do is I just draw a little trend line, connect the bottoms of this bad boy, and when it cracks, you know what? I trade, and I short it. And my stop goes above here. So I short 2,000 shares, and my stop is basically above 43. I shorted like 42, 65, so it's like $1,000. A little bit less than $1,000, 700, 800 bucks, right? And then it's all about reward to risk, you know? So my first target is really down to the low. And then if it breaks the old low, I'll keep a lotto position or a partial position and hold it a little bit lower. Right? That's it. It's not mathematicians. I mean, it's not mathematics. I mean, yeah. We got to know the highs or lows, but it's just a very, very simple setup that will get us through this. So just remember some of these things. You know, you get the VWAP trades, green to reds, opening range breakdowns, and then fade those gaps. Those are the things that I'm doing. Now, let's talk a little bit about risk management. Okay, and this type of market, we want to cut our position size. And I made this mistake in the beginning too. I had this huge loss maybe about a week ago. Okay, I had this huge loss about a week ago. And it came from just ego. You know, it sucked because I was doing really good. I hadn't lost in about 20 days. I was making about $3,000 every day. And then Friday came. And I broke all my rules. You know, I was trading a lot bigger. So the market was really wild. I lost $13,000, which is like way above my norm. You know, most of the days, like when I win, it's like I win $3,000 to $5,000. When I lose, it's like I want to lose $2,000 or $1,000. You know, it's something lower for proper risk management. And the market was really wild on Friday and Thursday and all this stuff. And I had a great week last week. I mean, I was killing it all week. And so my ego got really big. And I came into Friday, and I was, like, ready to conquer the world. And so, like, I went above and beyond what I normally do due to my greed, but also just breaking my rules of that, you know, in this type of market, because of the range. You know, if Amazon or any other stock is going to move 30 points or 40 points or 20 points, you don't need 1,000 shares of it, right? You only need a little bit of shares of it so you can control it, okay? One of the things that new traders make mistakes on and that makes them overreactive to little blurps on a chart or a stock is they have too much size. When you have too much size, you're reactive to the price of the stock because you're reactive to your P&L because you know you can't afford that loss. You have too many shares. And so all of a sudden you make bad decisions. In a bear market, because of the range, you don't need as many shares. And so you can cut your position size. That will allow you to breathe a little bit easier. Like, hey, I don't have $100,000 in this stock. I have $20,000. But because of the range, I can still make the same profits. And, you know, when I lost at $13,000, it sucked because I was like, I had huge, huge size. That's why I lost. It wasn't that the plays were that bad. Like, I lost like 80 cents on Netflix, which is a $120 stock. 80 cents is not nothing. It's not even 1%. But I had like 4,000 or 5,000 shares, where normally I trade like 500 shares in this thing or 1,000 shares. But I let my ego come into play and break all my rules on last Friday because I had made so much money that week. I just thought, like, hey, let me go for it. Let me see if I can have this huge day. And instead, I ended up giving back the whole week's profits, almost the whole week's profits, just from oversizing. Because, you know, losing 80 cents or a dollar on a Netflix is nothing. I mean, it's like 1%. But the position size makes it hurt. You know, and so you always want to cut it, because think about like Netflix today or like yesterday or something. Do I need 4,000 shares of Netflix? I mean, think about this like as just a human being, unless I'm just like this gluttonous animal, right? So like I shorted this yesterday at 113. It got down to 105. Today it got down to 101. I mean, right, you don't need 4,000 shares of this. It'd be nice, right? But you don't need it, right? If you had 500 shares, you would have had a nice day. You had 200 shares, you would have had a nice day. You had 100 shares, you would have had a nice day. You had 50 shares, you would have had still a nice day. But what happens is when you have too much size, you're overreactive to the stock goes up 20 cents, and you're like, oh my gosh, I'm down $800. But 20 cents on a $100 stock that moves this wild is nothing. It's part of its range. But the overposition size, it makes you into a different person. You're not trading now the stock. You're trading your P&L. And one of my mentors told me this a long time ago, and that was that, you know, in trading, you're not trading stocks. You're not trading stocks. You're trading your hopes and dreams. Yeah, he told me that. You're not trading charts, Canal. You're trading your hopes and dreams. You're trading your hopes and dreams. And that's what comes into play. You know what you're supposed to do. Like, I know what I'm supposed to do. Then when you start trading your hopes and dreams, right, things get in the way. And so it's always remember, ask yourself, like, am I doing the right thing? Am I trading this because it's the right move? Or am I trading this because I'm trading my hopes and dreams? Number two, take your quick hits in the first hour, okay? All the charts I showed you, everything I showed you, the big moves is that first hour, okay? Really the first 30 minutes. But you want to take the hits. You can't marry something because it's going in your favor. Don't get greedy. It'll come back the other way. In a bear market, even though the overall trend is down, there are huge, huge snapbacks to the upside because everybody's leaning one way. Number three, don't hold longs overnight unless the market's extremely oversold. This is just a rule of mine, and it's always been a rule of mine, and it's really kept me out of a lot of trouble. I started off Bulls on Wall Street as a swing trader. My mentor, Paul, best trader I know, maybe one of the best traders in the land. You know, like my savior, my mentor to this day. You know, he taught me something a long time ago, and that was that when the market is, you know, under its 50-day moving average, you know, that's your intermediate term moving average, gap downs are much more prevalent. Gap downs are much more prevalent, meaning, like, for example, the other day we gapped down 300 points. So if you were holding like a $20 stock, I'm just throwing an example, you're holding a $20 stock and the market gaps down 300 points, your $20 stock's gonna be like 18 bucks when you wake up without even the market trading. So when the market ended, it's 20 bucks. And when the market opened, it's 18 bucks. You weren't awake and there's nothing you can do in the middle. It just is down 2 bucks. There's nothing you can do about it. The market gaps. And so you don't want to hold longs overnight, either till the market gets above the 50-day moving average or it gets so oversold that it has to snap back and it's worth the risk, okay? Trading is all about reward to risk. And so you can only hold it overnight if it's worth the risk, meaning it's got to be so oversold, so stretched, that the odds are in your favor that there's a high probability situation where there's going to be a snap back, okay? That's the only time. So I use indicators like stochastics. Stochastics is something we use in a few different ways. You know, in our boot camp, the easiest way I tell my students to think about stochastics is when it's under 10, it's extreme oversold. You know, so when I put the stochastics indicator in my charts, when it's under 10, it's an extreme oversold, okay? That is one of the times where now you're starting to get some real stretch. Another thing I use is market breadth. Another thing I use when I'm swing trading especially is market breadth. So I use a T2108 indicator from Warden on market breadth, meaning the number of stocks trading above one of its moving averages. And so what happens is when this indicator starts to get really, really oversold, and anything under 10 is oversold, I start looking at the market as not a short, but a long. That it's come down so far that I think, and the probability suggests, that there is a short-term counter trend reversal in the making. And let me tell you, the most powerful rallies in the market are not in bull markets. Bull markets don't give you the biggest gains ever. Bull markets give you steady gains. But the most powerful rallies come in bear market rallies. Bear market rallies are the most powerful rallies. Why? Remember we already talked about the ranges are very, very huge. The volatility is very, very huge. And so what happens is when you get the bear market rallies, you get the shorts piling in, they got a cover, you get the volatility, and you can get those big, big runs. But it will test you. They don't just happen when you want them to happen. The bear market rally only happens when you have a certain recipe for when they should happen. And that comes from measuring oversold indicators, to measuring prices on a chart of when something is really stretched, to also measuring the support and resistance areas in the market. And when you couple them together, now you have some situations where you can say, hey, the market may not rally now, today, it's going to rally in the next couple days. I got support here, it's really oversold, it's really stretched, I got to play for the bounce. Because the worst thing you can do is try to short when the market is due for a bounce. Because when you're short and that market starts to bounce, you're going to be squeezed. You're going to lose so much money, right? And so you don't want to be squeezing into an over, you don't want to be shorting into an oversold market. You want to be shorting into a bear market. When it gets oversold, you got to start looking at it the other way. Narrow your watch list. So in a bull market, guys, I go through 1,000 charts every day. 1,000. I've been doing this since I was 18 years old. Think about how many charts I've looked at. 1,000 charts a day. I'm 34 years old. How do you know? What's 34 minus 18? It's a lot of years, right? 1,000 charts a day. So 200,000 charts a year. Just for my scanning, not even during intraday. I looked at 1 million charts. It's part of my process. I love charts. You know, if you don't love charts, you shouldn't trade. This is what I do. It's my passion, right? I love looking at charts. When I'm at a restaurant, I bring my laptop, I'm looking at charts. And when I'm in my bed, I take my iPad, and I'm looking at charts. I'm always looking at charts. I love charts. In a bear market, you can't look through 1,000 charts. They're all going to look the same. You narrow your watch list. You stick with the leaders. Stocks with the most liquidity and the most range. Okay? In bear markets, all stocks are going to have that big range. So, like in bull markets, we concentrate on low float plays, right? You know, for you guys that are my students or that have come into my webinars, you know I love low float plays. And low flow doesn't mean small price. You know, most people think low flow means $1 or $2, but that's not the case. Low flow means anything less than a float with 100 million shares. Tesla is a low float. Netflix for all those years, up until recently was a low float. Low float just means there's a less amount of shares available to buy. And if you think about it, like any big runner you've ever seen, you know, most of the reason that they can run so big is just essentially when they have the low float. You know, you see a stock that's 40 cents and it goes to $50. Why could that be? How can a stock go from 40 cents to $50? Not because it's like awesome. It has nothing to do with awesome. When it's a low float play, awesome has nothing to do with it. It's just a matter of supply and demand. When the float is so low that the smallest increase in buying power can send it going. And so you'll start to see, you know, in bull markets, those lower float plays tend to be really, really amazing, okay? Because they can do all sorts of stuff. In a bear market, guess what? Stocks are going to tank. People are going to sell. The float is not as meaningful. And so you want to stick with the market leaders, okay? So like, I do a lot less scanning now. I do zero scanning now, meaning that, you know, I have a couple stocks I'm looking at or I'll check around to see what's going on. But I keep basically I've had the same watch list now for probably 3 months, give or take. I've got a bunch of oil stocks because oil's been just getting pummeled. And then I have, you know, Amazon and Netflix and Facebook and so on and so forth, a couple biotech stocks, and that's really it. I haven't changed it much at all. Not doing as much scanning. I'm narrowing my focus list. And if you see on any given day, like what I'm trading, it's almost always, you know, UVXY, Netflix, Amazon, you know, like I have this, and then there's some of the same oil plays. WLL, OAS are always our go-to oil plays because they're the most liquid and they have the most range. I don't have to have too much more than that because in a bull market, some of the most obscure stocks tend to make the biggest runs, and you got to always be looking for them. In a bear market, it doesn't matter if it's an obscure stock or a well-known stock, everything's going to die. So you want range. You want something well-known, something with liquidity, something you can get in and out easy, because it's all going to be the same. You know, if you're going to short, you're going to short. Never short. This is huge, guys. It takes a while to learn this lesson, but it's so huge. We're always taught, so in bull markets, we're taught this, right? You buy the breakouts. Buy a breakout. Meaning you buy at highs, so you buy at high and then you sell higher. Well, that does never works in this type of market. Even when the market's breaking down and it's so nasty, you can never short the lower day. Anytime you short the lower day, never works. And you can never buy high of the day. You cannot buy breakouts. So those gap up plays or those awesome breakout plays that you'd be doing, they won't work. You cannot buy high and sell higher. You cannot short low and cover lower, okay? You've got to buy low, sell high, short high, cover low, meaning there's a lot more anticipation. You cannot trade on confirmation in this type of market, meaning like I'm going to get it confirmed when it breaks a level because it's not going to work. Like this UVXY trade, for example, today, right? Yeah, I was telling my guys, like this 40-50 mark is like so huge. 40-50 mark is like so huge. Like, you know, I kept testing this level. But like if you see, like if you try to short UVXY 40-50, all that would have happened is it would have just gone up to 41-50. You would have been out of it. Then you would have tried to short it at 41-50 again. Then it just popped up a dollar again. You would have been out of it. You would have got rid of your position, and then it tanks. So you never hit it on the low. We want to hit it early we want to hit it hard when in anticipation of, so like when everybody's trying to short this thing getting under 40-50, yeah, I already got this thing at 42-60, right? I've already hit it on a spike. And then I'm going down to the rest of the day. Then I'm going down the rest of the day. So you know, always remember that. Like I'm never, ever, even if it's an ORB or anything like that, I will never hit it the low of day. I will always have a certain amount of anticipation in it where I can manage my risk. Because even like an ORB, think about this. If the ORB in Amazon is 616, but the top of the candle is 626, are you going to keep a $10 stop on this thing? No. So you got to get it way in advance in anticipation. Anticipation. So, folks, I'm going to open this thing up to some questions and do all that fun stuff, but we got a 60-day boot camp starting in about a week from now, give or take a few days, okay? For many of you guys, you're getting the gist of what's happening. This is what my students go through every day. I have a 60-day boot camp. It's a 60-day class. There's 28 live classes taught via webinar, okay? And we go over everything that I know about trading, everything. My students have lifetime access to the boot camp. So when the markets change or things change, it doesn't matter. They're always coming into class. Even my guys that are professional traders and do this for a living will still show up for class because there are a handful of truths in life. You know, there's death, there's taxes, and there's on Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, Canal Desai is going to be on webinar teaching his students how to trade. I've been doing that for all these years, and that is one thing that has never changed. My schedule has never changed. I'm always Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, always on the tube, 8 p.m., okay? You get a course book with this. It's got everything. It is the trading Bible. We have a private community where our students hang out. Where our students hang out and they talk about stocks. They talk about their homework. They talk about their trades. What's awesome about some of the stuff that we do is that, like, I put my students on a simulator when they're done with class, and they upload their trades. They upload their trades and they share them with the rest of the community. And so people can look at it and say, hey, nice day, bad day, hey, try this on this thing. But you're sharing your work with 1,000 other people that have done this before. And so, and you can talk with them. People can post questions, whatever it might be. But that private community is where you're going to be able to hang out with your peers because, you know, I'm just one guy, sure. But I've got a whole team of people like me, like Zaman, you know, and Paul and Mary Beth and a whole host of other people that work at our company. And so, you know, we have all the internal support, but there are days you have a tough day that you don't want to ask your teacher, like, hey, did I do this wrong? There are just some days that you want to talk to a peer. You know, you want to talk to somebody that's doing what you're doing or going through what you're going through and having them explain it to you. Or sometimes you know what you did wrong, but you just need a pat on the back that says, hey, it's going to be okay. Or, hey, it's I was there too at one point, and I went through the same thing as you, and this is how I got past it. You know, I think some of that is just huge because trading is tough. I mean, this is the toughest game in the business, right? In any business, because it's completely dependent on you. It's completely dependent on you because you go through something like my class or anybody else's class or my class in particular. You're gonna know on a tactical and a strategical level everything that you need to know about trading. Like, you're gonna have it all, the tools and the tactics, but you still gotta go out and do it. There's so much of that mental game because you gotta be able to go out and get your fingers to click what your brain knows to click. And that's hard. Like, when I lost that $13,000, you know, my max on my loss, like what I'm, what I can stomach in a day and where I shut my account down is $5,000. And so I know it's $5,000. You know it's $5,000. My students know it's $5,000. My risk manager knows it's $5,000. And here we are. How do I go to 13? Because at some point, I have to get my fingers to do what I'm supposed to do. And that's what makes trading tough. But that's what makes trading awesome. That's what makes trading the best game on earth and also the worst game on earth. Because, yeah, it's tough, but I can live myself with, hey, I didn't click and get out when I knew I was supposed to get out. I'm responsible for my profits. I'm responsible for my losses. When I lose, it's not because I didn't know, I didn't have the skills, I didn't have the tools to succeed. It's because I couldn't get my fingers to do what I knew was the right thing to do. And that's what it will come down for almost all of you guys, is can you do that when you know you're supposed to do that? And it's hard, but it's also awesome when you think about it because you can do that. You have free will. You have the mental and physical capacity to make decisions and do it right when you know you're supposed to do it. You know, and most of the people you talk, like you talk to my students that lose, and there's tons of them that lose, and there's tons of them that win, but they'll always tell you, like, man, I knew I was not supposed to be in it, but I couldn't help myself. And that's so sad, but it's also awesome. Because that's something they can correct because it's an internal thing. They're not stupid. They know what they're supposed to do. They're educated. They just gotta work on their discipline a little bit. Disciplined people can make money trading. And so that's what's gonna be awesome about this class. I'm not just gonna work with you guys on trading. You know, my goal, my job, is to whip you guys into some shape, right? And show you how to win. And it's not just show you how to win in trading, but how to show you how to win in life, right? Show you how to win in business. How to show you how to be the best that you're supposed to be. I've had hundreds of students come and literally sleep at my house the last few years. And we have one rule. You want to trade with me? You come to my house and you sleep over. And you stay at my house. There's no such thing as hotels in my family, right? You come at the house, you do what I'm going to do, you work what I'm going to work, and we do this together. And just like I'm in Charleston right now, I have students come over, they're literally bringing their sleeping bags and sleeping on the floor. I'm seeing a bed and breakfast. The older lady that owns this place is like, boy, it's really creepy. You got a lot of young men staying at your house. And I'm like, it's not like that. They're my students. You know? She's like, why don't they stay at hotels? Because it's not allowed. In the family, we all stay together. You know, that's the way it goes. And that's where we're trying to go with this thing is, hey, I got to build you guys. I got to build you guys in a lot of levels, and I'm the guy to do that. Now, when class is over, we do market recaps, okay? Meaning that I'm on literally screen share. So, like, when I'm trading, so it's like our trading platform and all this stuff. I'm on screen share in the morning. And I usually just trade till about noon. But if I'm, I have all my stuff up. And I'm on screen share. And so when I'm clicking the buttons, you're going to see me click the buttons. We go to webinar just like we are now and post it in my chat room every morning. And I think this is kind of probably what separates me from most little gurus and are they still called gurus? I'm not even sure. But, you know, my students, they're in our chat room. And I'm on GoToWebinar, and so they'll see it. So I'm posting my alerts, but see, look, I'll post here a link for GoToWebinar. And so you're going to see my screen share. And I'm going to be posting my blah, 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 blah. And at the end of the day, I'm going to be posting my P&L. Hey, guys, this is what happened. And that's one of the things that makes what we do awesome. Because, yeah, it's one thing to learn something from a book. It's another thing to have somebody go out and do it, right? It's another thing for somebody to just put their balls on the kitchen table and say, here they are, I'm going to chop some vegetables. Right? It's not easy because there's a level of accountability to do that. And so you get to see me trade live. You'll see me hitting all these buttons and all this fun stuff. And I'll be posting, you know, my stuff and you know, all that stuff. It's fun. And also holds me accountable because, you know, I know that after the end of the trading day, we're going to have a market recap, meaning that we're going to go on video. We're going to talk about every single trade I took. What happened today? What happened in the market? What happened in your trades? And then from there, we're going to put our students on simulators, trading simulators to mimic what they've learned and also what they want to do, right? Work on your craft. And so I have set metrics. I know for a fact that if a student can hit these type of metrics when they're on the simulator, from profitability goals to number of wins versus losses, whatever it might be, I have a set metrics that I know can translate to good trade. Now, does it always do that? No. But these are I have some minimum standards. If you can't even do this on the simulator, you can't do this live. You know, if you do this on the simulator, there's a good shot you could do it live as long as you can get your fingers to do what you know you're supposed to do. Pretty cool, right? When you're done with the simulator, you will know on a technical level the things that you need to do to go out and make some money. Then it comes to conquering the head game. Conquering the head game. Conquering your hopes, your fears, your dreams. And then from there, hopefully we can get to some next steps. But that's where the support system comes in. We have interactive quizzes, homework. You have access to me on not just the chat room, but the screen share. Price of class is $2,500 if you pay in full. If you're doing payment plans, it's $999 down and 3 monthly payments of $550 or 6 payments of $475. Class starts in 5 days. You guys email Mary Beth. For you guys that don't know, Mary Beth is my better half. She's my first student, my business partner. She runs the show now. She's 8 months pregnant, so try not to piss her off. She's a lovely, lovely young lady, but her hormones are going, so don't make her mad. No, I'm just kidding. She's watching right now, so I just had to say that. But she's my business partner. Guys, Jordan, Chai, Mary Beth, all of these people that work for me that handle pieces of our boot camp, they all were students that at one point came in to a webinar just like this. They had no clue who I was. They never knew who I was. They showed up, they clicked the link, they came in, they started in the chat room, I trained them. Next thing you know, they're working with me and we're all partners in this. That's the cool thing about this boot camp. We've had some of our sales staff and our intern, Dennis, all of the people that work on our stuff were people that came in here and took our class and they had some talent or I needed them for this or that or they needed me for this or that or whatever it could be, and we're working together. And then the only people that are outside of the student circle that work at our company are my childhood best friends. You know, I get my three best friends, Boner, Omar Bentley, Tim, Tiny Tim, the Butt Dog, Kevin Sword. These are my three brothers. We can call them sometimes Dumb Dumber and Dumber, sometimes the Knuckleheads. But these guys are my best friends, my brothers, my inspiration, and also the guys that really support me to do everything. So those are the other guys that work for me. So we got a family business out there. It's pretty cool. You probably talk to all of them. They're like the damn coolest dudes in the world. They really are. We got our whole family together again coming up, and it's good to see. So, guys, email Mary Beth. Oh, by the way, you know, you can email me anytime you have any questions or anything. My number is 7. This is my cell number. You can just hit me up. Now, I do warn you, sometimes when I'm trading and somebody calls me like, hello, I'm a little bit rude because I'm trading. I'm in the heat of battle. And when you're in the heat of battle, sometimes you're a little bit rude on the phone. Like, you ever hear me in the chat room on a video all day when a telemarketer calls? I telemarket them. I'm like, hello? Do you know what you're doing? He's like, what? I'm like, I have $672,000 short of Amazon stock right now. Do you really want to be bothering me right now? And, you know, so on and so forth. But anytime if I'm not trading, I will pick up. I love text. I love all this stuff. I will pick up, man. If I'm a day late, I apologize, but I'll do my best. You know, I really will. Email Mary Beth if you want info on the boot camp, or just email me, whatever. You want to talk some shop? I'll be honest with something. I have so many damn students, thousands upon thousands, maybe tens of thousands over the years. You email me, I wouldn't even know if you're a student or not. I probably know because I'm really good with names, but I probably wouldn't, right? I answer every email I get in my own time. So that's the nature of the beast. Let me answer some questions, and hopefully you guys enjoyed yourself. And guys, 2016, go out and get it. Go out and get it. You know how many times people say tomorrow, I'm going to do this tomorrow, and tomorrow never happens. Sometimes late becomes never. You know how many times late becomes never? All the time. You don't want to be late, and you never want to be never. This is your year. You're going to really go out and do something? Go do it. And let me tell you something. Nobody can wing anything. You know, I had a mentor, Paul, and Mary Beth has a mentor, me. And, you know, that's just the circle of life. Let me tell you something. I tried for 5 years. 5 years to learn how to trade from books. And you know what I got in return for those 5 years? Maybe $60,000 to $70,000 in loss. That's what I got for trying to learn it from books. Because books suck. Reading sucks, right? I mean, who wants to read? Unless you're reading 50 Shades of Grey or some other bogus stuff. I mean, reading takes a long time. It sucks. Hey guys, any contests or anything like that? You gotta email Mary Beth. Email her right now. Hello, Pat Harris from Harris Market. Hey Harris, how you doing? Guys, thank you. I have not. I've seen Christopher Zielinski numerous times since I've been here. He's one of my best students. You can check out his website, Green Bar Trading. He's awesome. Ernesto Bolino, how you doing, sir? Jonathan from Virginia Beach, what's going on? Michelle Priceman, I'm so honored to coach you in a week or so. Dimitri, my man, if I make it out when the weather warms up in Greece, I will try to make my way. Hey Sean, how you doing? So Sean's asking me, guys, what do I consider a big picture? I'm just talking about the daily chart, the overall trend of the market of the last few months. Of course, when you're looking at the biggest picture, big picture, what's been happening recently of the last month is more important than what happened 6 months ago. Hey, Tesla did, Mr. BG, Tesla did, Tesla did have, it was a little bit extended. It went green to red, then it had just a quick one. You know, when the market rebounds, all these stocks rebound too. That's just kind of the nature of the beast. It's been fading its gaps really well. Tesla's a stock you got to keep on your watch list on a daily basis. Hey, Durin Shah, I use a candle closes versus opens, I think. Hey, Shoab, guys, so Shoab is saying, hey, I'm using looser stocks, but I'm still getting hit. My stop losses are still getting hit. So what's the problem? Well, the problem, and that's actually very simple. The problem is, look, you get the best stop in the world, but if your entry is not the right spot, you're always going to get stopped out. In risk management, your entry is really the most important thing. If your entry is not precise, then whether your stop is a good place or not is not going to matter. And so you have a Shoai Sapululik Luku Luku. Shit. I'm sorry. I'm so bad with names. Even though you're a brown person like me, I should know how to say your name. So, I gotta say, SS, my man SS, your entries need to be changed. Hey, Ashish, yeah, CYBR did have a nice day. Hey, Marina, how you doing? Marina's saying in a bear market, are shorts more prevalent than, you know, the bull market? And I would say, yeah, I mean, we're doing a lot more shorting. Hey, Darren, how you doing? Darren's asking about the number of the time frame of candles I watch. And I watch 5-minute candles, meaning 5-minute charts. And the reason for that, guys, is that 1-minute charts make me overtrade. You know, everybody's a little bit different, but I find the 1-minute charts, they just bring out the demons in me And one of the things that I have a weakness as a trader, and I just have to recognize and accept it, is that I overtrade. I'm an overtrader. I, Canal Desai, am an overtrader. And so as an overtrader, I just have to be really cognizant of that and take steps to not get into those messes. And one of those things that get me in the mess is overtrading and 1 minute charts. Hey Paul, how you doing? Where do I keep my watch list prepared for the day? On here, and I use TC2000, and you know, we talk about it in the chat room in the morning, like, hey, this is what we're ready to do. And then you know, we have a blog usually where we do a nightly watch list. That's, man, I'm a good looking guy, right? No, I'm just kidding. Then we have a regular nightly watch list. So this would be our watch list for tomorrow. Hey Michelle, it's good to know Michelle Price. I love people from Brooklyn. My best friend's from Brooklyn right now. He lives in Williamsburg. I'm gonna be there, I think, in a month or two. So we'll have to meet up. Mr. Cliff Mayhew, yes, FOMO is huge. Dimitri, how you doing? Dimitri is saying, would you trade the U.S., the European markets, the same way that you do the U.S.? I think so. I would take the same strategies. Every market will have their own nuances, maybe from times of day to, you know, different stocks that tend to move well or so on and so forth, or just like sectors. But in general, the pattern should be the same. What would take some time is more just me observing what's going on in the market, like what's moving, what's not moving, and then, you know, just more mentally just keeping track of that stuff. Carl, my man, how you doing? Carl Lamundi, what's your average hold period? Mostly I'm just day trading. I usually have like maybe 2 to 3 stocks max for swing trades, but mostly just day trading. Mr. Lou Elliott, how you doing? In the current market, would you swing a short overnight? I would swing shorts overnight only when I don't think the market's going to bounce. You know, if the dailies are telling me the market's due for a bounce, then I can't swing short because the market's going to rip. But if you're catching something in the day, right, 1 or 2 of a move, then it's much easier. Paul Jean, is that because you have less movement at that time of day? Yeah, it's just happened. I don't know why the rules are, why it is the way it is, but middle of the day just tends to be more of a smaller range. Mr. Verrett, Dennis Verrett, how you doing, buddy? My man from Michigan. My boy. Dennis saying, are you doing pretty much the same scans? Dennis, I'm not doing any scans right now. The same stocks are going to be in play pretty much every day. I'd rather play some of the same things over and over than try to find some new hot stock that's going to move the same as everything else. Things are just going to move with the markets right now. You don't need to overcomplicate things. Mr. Bill Sis, yes, I believe this is being recorded. Mr. Burt, thank you. I appreciate it. Sander, how you doing? Mr. Bayer, what's going on? Francisco, how you doing? For the most part, I would stay away from some Francisco saying about like trading setups. Can I do flat tops if the market's going? I'd say no. Today, flat bottoms and flat tops, they didn't really work out. Get them low, sell them high, no matter what. Get them on a 1-2-3 pattern, get them low, sell them high. And Mr. Gregory, part of the ORB happens to be like what's supposed to happen with the market. For example, if the market is down 5 or 6 days in a row, and then Amazon or something were playing gapped down, then I would probably try to play to the upside because the market should go the upside. If it was day one of a bear flag or day two of a bear flag or something like that, and it gets down and the stock's not too extended at this point, it's had some rest, then I would be taking it to the downside. But I'd also be following the price action of it and really digging in. Hey, Michelle, love you, baby. It's good to see you in here. Hey, Aaron Huber, the bootcamp winner stuff is usually always done by Mary Beth. Hit her up. Hey, Andres Lazaru, man. I love you too, man. Hey, Brittany, how you doing, man? Tell Corey I said hello. Gagan, how you doing? Gagan's asking, guys, what computer I use. I don't have anything too special. I got like an Asus. I got Intel i7, 16 gigs of RAM, and I believe 1 terabyte hard drive. And then for my emails and Facebook and Max.com, I use an Apple MacBook Pro with 16 gigs of RAM. 16 gigs of RAM seems to be like the necessary thing. That's got an i7 and 1 terabyte SSD also. SSD is the way to go. But I just use the Mac for Facebook, Max.com, Twitter. It's like a $4,500 paperweight. But, dude, Macs are so cool. Right? Because the reason why Macs are so cool is because you can literally turn your MacBook into like an iPhone. It's like, you log in your iCloud, all your apps show up, and then it's all the same stuff. Eric's question is, Eric Flockin, buying this market green to red moves, or is it 90% short selling? I don't know. I mean, a buy is a buy and a sell is a sell. Whether it's short selling or buy selling, or doesn't really matter. I'm just more following the price action. Vikram, how many students do you usually have stay with you when they train with you? Most of the time, the students come one by one. I have people at the house all the time. They say, hey, Camille, I want to come over. Are you home? I say, yeah, I'm home, and they come over. If I'm not home, then I'm not home. If I'm in Charleston or Hawaii or Bali or wherever I am, I've taken some of my students to Costa Rica. Wherever I am, if they can come, then they can come. I mean, but I have no set times of when I'm at home. I do have in the summertime like a week or two where I just have a bunch of students over at once, like more like a frat house type of thing. This year was pretty cool. We had like Jake and Sean and Pastor Blake. Pastor Blake's awesome. And a couple others. And, we just traded for like the whole week. And then I took them on a dolphin cruise and we got drunk on White Zinfandel and did some weird shit. It was pretty cool. Hey, Mankin, how you doing? Mankin is asking, can I go over the format of the bootcamp one more time? Yeah. So first month, live classes, 4 days a week, 8 p.m. Eastern time. Every class is recorded, archived, and put on a on the website with all the tools and things that you need, from your quizzes to the old bootcamp videos, to you know your registration links, whatever you need, additional education, it's all there. Bootcamp setup, scanner, anything you need, it's all there. And but this is all just like the recordings. I'm doing them live, of course, and so it's all there, and you can retake bootcamp as many times you need to. From there, once the live class is over, you're going to watch me train. I'll be on screen share. You're going to watch the man do what man do, right? I'm going to win. I'm going to lose. I'm going to be a hero in a stock way. And I'm going to be a goat in a stock way. You know, there's going to be good days and bad days, and we're going to talk about them. We're going to go over them after class and talk about them, what happened, what didn't happen, good or bad. You guys are going to do your business plans. I'm going to help you guys do your business plans. We're going to start talking about what type of trading you want to do and how what you learn in classes. In class, guys, I teach you guys about all types of trading, swing trading, day trading, everything, right? That's what we do. So you're going to start articulating what you do, want to do. You're going to build a business plan. You're going to go in a simulator. You're going to upload your trades to the community so that everybody can look at them. When you get to a certain place, then you can go live. And making, you know, email me if you have any questions, just, you know, whatever you need. Jorge, but also, what's going on? Hey, Kate, how you doing? I do travel a lot. Home is, you know, I have a house in Destin, Florida. I don't know if it's home or not. Sometimes it's home. It feels like home, but my friends are not there yet. My friends just went back to Michigan. And so without Dumb and Dumber and Dumberest, right, there is no home. My parents and Dumb, Dumber, and Dumberest are all in Michigan right now. Hey, Matt, I am kind of in a good mood. I love doing webinars for some reason. Cody Glasgow in the house. What's going on? Jesse, I've blown up quite a few accounts in my younger days. I mean, it's been a decade since I've had to do it again. Guys, when you're newer, there are times that you're going to just have bad luck. You're going to blow up some accounts. These days, the good thing is, you know, you don't have to have $25,000 or $30,000 blow up accounts. Most of the time, when you blow up accounts, it'll be $2,000 or $3,000. You know, nowadays, with what we do at our hedge fund and stuff like that, you know, you can day trade with a lot less capital than you needed before. Hey, Dane. Dane, how you doing? Dane's, you should come to New Orleans for Mardi Gras. You know, New Orleans, it's too cold for me in February. Too cold. I'm about to get out of the States, man. It's way too cold. I'm trying to go to, does anybody know where this is? Sayulito, Mexico, and then from there I'm going to Medellin, Colombia, and then, I don't know, I'm trying to get to Brazil. Hey, Jason Kudo, how you doing? Sometimes I long stocks and positive earnings or news. Just depends on the overall look. If the gap was into a crappy place, I would not long. So, like, for example, let me show you. Good question, by the way, Jason. Let me see. What the fuck was that name of that stock I was trading the other day? Hold on. TTNP. So like TTNP the other day, gapped right into this big chunk of resistance. Hold on, let me close this chunk. See this? had this huge gap on what was awesome earnings or whatever, and they just faded off because it's not clean. It's just a big, it just gapped up in a big pile of doo-doo. Something gaps up in a big pile of doo-doo, I take out my pooper scooper, and I short it, right? You don't want to long that. But if it was clean, I would maybe think about it, but most likely not, unless it was just something epic. Michael Zola, for all we can do right now is just play the levels. You know, if this level breaks, we're going to get nasty, right? If you break over this level, maybe you get a little bit more upside. That's your next level of resistance, you know, like from where today was. You know, if you get here, then you have to start watching it more closely on smaller time frames, see if it's going to roll over. If it bases out, breaks through, then you got more upside. Hey, Jennifer Hogg, how you doing? Hogg. I hope I said that right. I don't want to try to call you a hog. Hey, Darren Farrell, you want to use Thinkorswim? You use Thinkorswim, buddy. Hey, Brittany Smith, you're going to have to message Mary Beth about any winner of boot camp stuff. I didn't even know we had a contest. Hey, Evan, how you doing? Evan's question, I'm currently a professional poker player, and I've always been interested in doing day trade. Do you have any other students that do the same thing? Yeah, you know, I got the Persian Pirate. The Persian Pirate was a poker player. The one thing, Evan, I'd say about almost everybody that's ever played poker, someone says they're professional poker players. So I've had like dozens of students that are professional poker players. I don't think anyone really is that good at poker. I mean, to me, a professional poker player is somebody that made millions of dollars, right? You're professional. I mean, shit, hopefully you made a couple mil. So most of my students that said they were professional poker players, they were poker players. But they may not have I don't know. I mean, I've had a lot of people say they were professional poker players, but they might not have been that good at poker. So I don't know if the translation's always there. The other thing I would also say is that almost every teacher I've ever seen compares poker to trading. And I haven't seen, even though everybody thinks it's there, I don't know if the translation is there. The translation is there in terms of having the balls and knowing how to manage your risk and all that stuff. But day trading requires instantaneous decisions, sometimes within 1 or 2 seconds. So you don't have the ability to, like, sometimes just wait your turn. In day trading, often when your turn is your turn, it's time to go. So that would see, I think that's where the main difference is. Is sometimes just the speed of day trading. You know, like today, I made like 8 trades in like the first 3 minutes. And I was like, I didn't have any time to think about it. I was like, and then before you know it, it's like, oh my God, I blacked out. You know, but the risk management principles and knowing when to bet and not to bet and those type of things are really prevalent. And so, yeah, Mary Beth, she actually usually is the one that works with some of the guys like that, but Alex DeRudy is one of our students. He was a poker player. Ryan, he's a poker player. So, you know, we have some of these guys that they've been playing some poker. I don't know if the correlation or success ratio is more or less. I think it's still dependent on the person. Hey, Mr. Dutcher, how you doing, sir? Hey, Mr. Tommy, how you doing? I think I actually talked to one of your friends on Instagram that lives in Charleston. Hey, Tanvir, how you doing? You know, most of our students start off with like $2,500 or $5,000. Mr. Preston, the fourth phase of the market cycle is rundown. Hey, Gracie, how you doing? Will you go over VWAP and everything else in the boot camp? Of course. Gracie, there's nothing in boot camp that I will not go over. It's a very long class. I'll need stuff to talk about. Hey, Christian, Mr. 541 area code, Oregon. What's up, baby? Hey, Jonathan, how you doing? Could you describe the lifestyle of a day trader? Would a part-time trader only trade on open times? So, Jonathan, a part-time trader would be do more swing trades. There's not necessarily more money in day trading or swing trading. Money is more dependent on your level of skill. So a swing trader is like somebody that holds stocks for 2 days to say 10 days. And you're not going for like a bunch of 1% or 2% gains. You're going for 20 or 30% gains. Going for bigger trades with less amounts of trade because you're a part-time trader. And day trader is more doing the tat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat, you know, all day long. But it's not necessarily one's better than another. Sometimes it's a function of your job. Sometimes it's a function of your personality or your bankroll, whatever it might be. So, like, as a day trader, you know, you're at the computer and you're doing what you're doing. You might be at the computer all day because that's what you like to do. Versus a swing trader, they're going to set their positions. They're going to check out in the morning. They might check out at the end of day. Mostly all swing trading also can be done from the phone because your homework's going to be done at night. Eric Waka Flocka. Eric Waka Flocka, baby. Do you ever play the spreads? Not really. Hey, Ray Carjaval, what's going on? How you doing? Besides TC1000, what subscriptions or software do you use? Sometimes I use Trade Ideas. I use Quote Tracker. That's really it. Hey, Kate Guzabuldi, Guzabuzowski. There's a Bozuski. What's going on? What kind of computer monitors you use? Okay, I've been on, so November 16th, I took off on the road. I left my house in Destin. In Destin, I have a desktop computer with two 27-inch monitors. November 6th, 17th, I took off on the road. I went to Hawaii. Then I went to Bali. I went to Charleston, and I've just been on a 15-inch Asus laptop, and then I use a Asus USB monitor. You can get them on Amazon for like $150. Asus USB monitor. You can get two of them even if you want. I only need one, but you hook them on the side. You can plug them into your laptop. Now you got like multiple screens, which are very mobile and they're very, very thin. So it's pretty cool. And really, I mean, how much more do you need? I mean, we're just traders. Hey, Tim Murphy, how you doing? Question about the bootcamp simulator. Is it done every day for a month during market hours, or can it be done after hours? So, Tim, we have two options. We have one that's during market hours, and then we have a market replay simulator that we can use where you can rewind any day in the market and simulate it like it's today. Hey, Sunny Singh, and you're an Indian guy, you should know this. Sunny is saying, hey, I got a small account, so I can't trade anything but small cap stocks. Well, theoretically, that's true, but theoretically, it's actually not true. So, for example, say you have $1,000 and you have a $1 stock and you invest that $1,000 into it, what do you have? 1,000 shares. And if it goes up 10%, those 1,000 shares, the $1 stock, how much do you make? $100. Say you have a $100 stock. and you have 10 shares of it. What does that equal? $1,000. And say that stock goes up 10%. $10 times how many shares? You have 10 shares. It ends up being the same thing. So if you have $1,000 of a $100 stock, it goes up 10%. It's the same amount of money. It's a $100 gain as 1,000 shares of a 10-cent stock, or a dollar stock going up 10 cents, 10%. Sorry. So it ends up being the same stuff. The other thing I suggest is work. Sometimes you gotta get a second job. Sometimes you gotta do a freelance. I can do all sorts of shit to get my trading account to where it needed to be so I can make some money. And I was just a kid. You know, I had odd jobs and I was doing this. I took out student loans. Whatever I had to do, I first perfect your craft. When you know you can make money, keep saving. You know, don't put it in your trading account right away, but keep saving. Take odd jobs. Take a second job. Consult. Build your skills, and then when it's time, you know. But don't, before it's time, don't put the money in your account. Hey, Gene, bro, what about us that don't have money to start trading those stocks to trade? Gene, I'll trade anything from 5 cents to $5,000. I don't care. Because 10 cents or 10% is 10%. Doesn't matter. It really doesn't. It's, you have 10 shares of a $600 stock, or you have 6,000 shares of a $1 stock, it's still easier to make money on the higher price stock. 10% is 10%. Mr. Wickham, how you doing, sir? Can you run off the four cycles of the market again? Yes. Accumulation, run up, distribution, run down. What's the best way to identify a bull or bear market? Well, Luis, you know, bear market only comes around every blue moon. So look at your moving averages. Market below moving averages all sloping down. Look at the distribution cycles. Look at the news. Look at the price action. And you got yourself an idea. The easiest way is really just to take your major moving averages. Look at the slope. Hey, Esteban, how you doing? What do you think about oil companies? Oil companies suck. I've been literally trying to bounce these oil companies for a month, and all I do is lose. It's a good thing I've been winning on everything else. Hey, Michael LeMay, how you doing, man? Guys, Michael LeMay was my first personal trainer. He is the man. He looks like Mr. Clean. If you mix Mr. Clean with the Ultimate Warrior. Hey, Jesse, is a short percent the same as a long? If I short or with my P&L, I should show 100%. Jesse, if you short, it just says, instead of the amount of shares, it just says negative in front of the shares, and then you'll still have your P&L. It'll literally look like a long. It just says a minus in front of the shares. Jonathan, Masa, before you trade, you do research on companies, i.e. Change in leadership. No, I trade the charts. I trade momentum. I trade trends. I trade chart patterns. But I do not trade balance sheets, income sheets, things of that nature. Evan, do you get more chicks now that you make millions? No. I wish. I really wish. You would think so, but that is not the case. Hey, Kuni Okamoto, I don't run any special scanners during the midday to look for XYZ setup. If I have, I say I have my core list of 5 or 10 stocks I'm watching, one of them is going to do a midday setup. You don't need 50 ideas. You just need one. And so when you have a handful of setups you're trading, in your core group of stocks that you're watching, and most of the days I'm watching between 4 to 6, one of them is going to do that. And make sure you're watching the right one before the market opens. Hey, Brittany, how you doing? She's asking, do you trade anything like options or Forex? Nope. No. Not because there's anything wrong with it. It's just, you know, I'm a trader. It's just what I do. Nafis, how you doing? Nafis Fatima, how much money do you suggest one has to have to start trading? The more the merrier. You know, the problem with trading is when you have a really small account, you don't have a margin for error. You can start trading with $2,500 or $5,000. But if you make a few mistakes, then you're out of the game. When you have more money, you have the opportunity to make more mistakes and your learning curve is not as stressful. You know what I mean? And so I've seen a lot of traders start off really small, and I've seen a lot of traders start off with a little bit more capital, and it just seems like the ones with a little bit more capital have less stress. It doesn't mean that really – it's not the success ratio that, you know, per them, but the more money you have, the more opportunity you have to learn a couple lessons. And you're going to have to learn some lessons in trading. Remy, where you been at, baby? Where you been at? Do you tend to go long or short? Both. How do you short hard to borrow stocks, guys? I have my own hedge fund. My students trade inside my hedge fund to take our bootcamp class. I give them the best borrows around. We can short almost anything, and anything that's not shortable, I can make some calls and find the shorts. I usually got to pay a little bit of money, and we can find the shorts, and then we can short them. Hey, Jason Munoz, how you doing? How much taxes must a day trader pay? The same as you would pay if you were in any tax bracket as a working person, depending on how much money you make. You know, if you're making $100,000, you're going to pay a lot of taxes. And if you lost money, you would pay no taxes. Hey, Mr. Scott, how you doing, sir? Yes, I did record it. Hey, Mr. Tom Ford, how you doing? You know, Tom, say, hey, I'd love to trade bull flags or pennants. So on the daily charts, in this type of market, you're probably going to be shorting those things. But also scan for gap downs rather than just always gap up. Esteban, I don't know anything about oil companies besides the fact that they suck to trade right now. Michelle Priceman, is Mary Beth really pregnant? She's like 8 months and some change. I'm about to head down to Mississippi in about a week or so to make sure I don't miss it. I'm going to take that baby out right there and keep it, probably. I'm going to try to keep it. Mr. Brian Boyd, how you doing? So Brian's asking, like, is boot camp for like more experienced traders or newer traders? Boot camp is for all types of traders, but I start everybody in boot camp at step one so that we can build a foundation. A house is only as strong as its foundation. Hey, Michelle, how you doing? Who's your broker? I have my own broker, my own hedge fund. Me and my students, we trade there so we can kind of get the tools and the commissions and everything the way we need them. Hey, Ty. Tyler Blanchard, man. What's going on, baby? I miss you, man. Tell your girlfriend I said hello. I love you guys. Eric, in the last probably 2.5 years, I probably spent like 8 months in Costa Rica, 7 months. Hey, Lily John, how you doing? Lily's asking about entries. You know, how do you know what the right entry is? The entry is very specific to patterns, you know? I don't put too much weight on entry by the exact penny. I'm talking about when I want a good entry, it's about the pattern, managing my risk, and getting a stock at an inflection point where my risk is really small, but the stock is about to explode. Trading is very much trading around inflection points, that very specific area where stock's going to explode, but your risk is small. And that means trading inside those patterns, but waiting till that right moment, right before they move. Hey, Mr. Ford, how you doing? What brought you to feel an accomplishment in trading career? To be honest, I still don't feel very accomplished. I'm working more now than I did 10 years ago. I'm working harder now than probably anybody in this webinar. You guys think you're struggling? I'm struggling. I'm going for it. Guys, it never ends. It never ends. The growth never ends. The learning never ends. Your struggle never ends. You know, yeah, I may have gotten some things down in training over the years, but we all have things that hold us back. You know, we all have things that are our own demons that are inside our head that, you know, we're uncomfortable with or self-conscious about. Every person has that. You're never going to feel totally accomplished. I've never had that moment where I just sit back and I'm like, you know, I have some cool moments. You know, I just spent a month with my parents in Bali and Hawaii and with my sister. And it was cool because they're like, man, thanks for the awesome vacation. But it wasn't really like this aha moment of like, man, dude, I just spent $25,000 on a vacation with my parents and my sister. They're so happy. It wasn't even like that. They're like, thanks, butthead. And I was on my computer looking for stocks, you know? Like, things really don't change as much as you think. Your parents are still going to treat you like a kid. Your sister's still going to treat you like a butthead, no matter how much money you have. And you're still always going to struggle with something. It could be your trading. It could be that you're feeling lonely. It could be that you don't like your body or your skin or whatever. I don't know. But, you know, we all have something. And you never truly get to that point, I don't think, where you're just like, oh, I'm so happy. You know, sure, you can meditate and become a hipster and drink Pabst Blue Ribbon and talk about being happy and smell and wear funky clothes and live in Brooklyn. I don't buy it. I'm never happy. I'm always happy, but I always want to get better, you know? And so I haven't had that moment yet where I just sit back and I'm like, wow, this is so cool. Like, we have some moments where we reflect on it and we say, hey, we come a long way. But we've never had a moment where we said we came all the way. You know, like, I work with my three best friends, and my three best friends, I'm the smartest one, but I'm a troublemaker. You know, the other two guys, you know, they're so smart, but it's not like we're like master's degree type guy. We got Omar and Kevin and Tim, and, you know, none of us have, we're not like degree, master's degree guys. You know, we're all from Detroit, baby. Hey, we're from, you know, we're blue. We're like the richest blue-collar people you're ever going to see. And we always have that mentality. And so, I don't know. We've never really felt like that. Some days, there are every blue moon. Like, you know, it could be like in a New Year's or something where we look, kind of look around and we're like, dude, where are we? Like, man, this is cool. We're like on a beach in Thailand or, you know, wherever. Like, hey, who would have thought we're here? And we kind of look around and we high-five each other. But then it's the next day. It's, you know, what do we got to do next? Like, where are we going? How are we doing this? You know, let's keep moving. Jose, how you doing? Jose's saying, you know, Jose is asking, like, he's having trouble pulling the trigger. What is holding him back? Well, it could be a few things. Competence breeds confidence. Competence breeds confidence. Having a methodology, a system, where you know how to handle and can see every angle in the market and a stock instantaneously, that's good. When you know I'm A, B, C, D, E, it's got to happen before I take a trade, that instantly gives you confidence, okay? A lack of confidence comes from I don't have the competence, the methodology to tell me what I need to do, and then it's just a matter of repetition. And so I'm not saying you don't know anything about trading, but once you know exactly what you're supposed to do at every given instant, the methodology, then you got to go out and repeat it. And when you repeat something over and over and over and over and over again, that repetition builds your skill level. It brings up your competence level. And now from that, you will have confidence, okay? And so that's where you've got to get. If you don't have the confidence yet, you can get there. It's not an internal thing like I lack confidence as a person. What you've got to think about is trading as a system or a method. Do I have a recipe? You know, a trade should be like a recipe. You know, when you look at a cookbook, you see like 20 things line up before you, you know, to make a cake, right? There's like 20 different things in the cookbook. Pinch of this, pinch of that, batter this, batter that, shake this, shake that, da-da-da-da, vanilla this, chocolate that, right? But it's to the penny, to the pinch. It's a very exact recipe. Trading is the same way. At any given moment, you should have a very specific recipe on how to handle that. And if you don't have that step by step, then it's hard to repeat the right move. And so if you can't repeat it over and over, you may need 1,000 repetitions of doing it the right way to build the confidence. And so you got to start all the way in the beginning and say, do I have every angle covered? Hey, Anthony, we do sell these Bulls hats. Email Mary Beth. She's got them all. Hey, Carl, how you doing? Yeah, right now I did close all my trades into the next day. Hey, Mr. Scott, I am like Mr. Scott's asking if I'm a vegan. I'm actually I'm an anti-vegan. Not I'm against vegans, but the only vegetables I eat is like cheese, And the only green thing I like is money. Hey, Scott, I like version 16 TC 2000. I love it. It's awesome. I love TC 2000, man. It's cool. Hey, Jason. Jason Kudos asked about scanning. Jason, you know, rather than just thinking about 4% down, you know, have something a little bit more comprehensive of, hey, I'm going through these type of stocks because this is what fits the market. I have my gappers, and then I have stocks that I'm scanning for that are trending XYZ. Norberto, Argentina, what's going on? I got so many students in Buenos Aires, man, you wouldn't even know. Norberto, Twitter is a big wasteland of finances. Let me tell you why Twitter is just a big giant piece of doo-doo. I mean, this stock's like in a never-ending downtrend. It's been downtrend now since 2014. See that? Lower high, lower high, lower high, lower high, lower high. So, yeah, it bounced a little bit today. But it's not... It bounced today because the market bounced. You know, it's not like there was like this surefire awesome setup that you had to get into. This is, you know, you didn't screw up. It's just the market's down. It's not going to bounce. And this is a shitty stock in general. Hey, Andre, how you doing? Any good mobile apps with free candlestick charts? I'm not a big fan of trading on mobile, but you could probably look at TC 2000. Hey, Remy, what simulator do you recommend for paper trading? Man, the regular simulators just suck. Remy, hello. Man, there's like a bunch of random web contest kind of simulators. You'd probably have to ask Mary Beth. You know, we have some specific ones we use for our boot camp. That Mary Beth puts everybody on. But beyond those, I don't know. I mean, I haven't found very many good simulators I like. Like, when people ask me about simulators, I'm like, I don't like that one. I don't use it. Oh, by the way, the brokers, who, you know, like your broker will have the best simulator. Hey, Lewis, yeah, the simulator that we use and the classes can be done on a Mac. Hey, Gene, how you doing? Isn't that risking too much? You're literally going all in on that example. Gene, I go all in all the time. Because when you think about all in, don't think about, hey, if I bet $500,000, I can lose $500,000. That's not how it goes. And whatever it is. That's why we use margin. Say you have a stock at $50, okay? You feel like you can risk $500, okay? You could have 1,000 shares of it, and you would just be, if you had a 50-cent stop, you would be risking $5,000. If your stop loss was, say, 25 cents away, you could have 2,000 or 3,000 shares, and you'd still be risking a very small amount. And so your risk is not necessarily about how much money you put into a stock, but from where you buy and where your stop loss is. So, like, you can buy a 30 cent, if you were buying a $30 stock and you had a 10 cent stop loss, you know, you could have 3,000 shares or more, right? And you'd still be risking a small amount. Hey, Eric, you know, we have our own platform. I use the app trade, and most of the time it's just, you know, I have like three montages up, and, you know, we're kind of in and out and stuff. I don't have like eight things up and try to hit eight all at once. It's just that's where the volatility is. You know, I'm in and out of one thing, I'm moving to the next thing. Hey, Alexis, how you doing, brother? Hey Scott, how you doing? In bear markets, do you ever use leverage inverse ETFs? Yes, I do. UVXY is one of them. TNA, TZA, you know, those type of things. Hey Kim, how you doing? Kim Tran's asking, what type of trading do I do in my IRAs? I do more swing trades, those 2 to 20 day type of holds. If I got to go short the market, I use inverse ETFs, guys. Inverse ETF is like, say you wanted to short the S&P 500. You know, there's an ETF that you can go long, but it shorts the S&P 500. Or I could go long UVXY. Hey, Lewis, you know, I made like $1,000 on the GoPro. I didn't have very many shares. I shorted this thing right here at the 20 EMA, and I covered down into this flush right over here. My target was the VWAP. I got exactly a 1261 entry for a couple thousand shares. Then I covered some here, 12, 20, and then I covered some in like 12, and then I covered the rest of 1180s. You know, I took a decent gain out of it. I wish I had more shares. Yeah, sheesh, that's good, man. It's good to have some savings. That will help you. What should I do before jumping full-time in trading? I'd make sure you can make money every day or every week, and you do it consistent. You have, you know, 3 to 6 months of savings of your living expenses, more if you have kids. You know, as a parent, I mean, right, you know, your dream of trading is very secondary to being a dad, you know, so you got to have money saved up. You know, that's, I think, going to be just huge, because it's a lot of pressure. You know, you can be a really good trader, but you need to have two really adorable kids. It's hard to trade sometimes if you don't have the income of work, right? I don't know. I mean, that's how I'd be. It's just like, you have your dream of a trader is here. And it's always been your dream, but right, that at some point you become a parent, and your dreams are not your dreams, right? Your kids' dreams are really your dreams, and they're way up here. And so, you know, you always have to balance that of like, hey, I guess, you know, it's different. When you're single, you can take a little bit more risk and do some stuff you can't do when you have a family of support. And so you gotta save a little bit more money, and you gotta be sure, like, hey, I can make money doing this. Like, I'm good. I have proof. I make money. I feel confident. I have setups that last in every market, and I have savings. I have enough money to fill my trading account, but maybe I need a backup trading account in case I actually fuck up and that trading account doesn't last, right? You know, you gotta have all that. Mr. Dugan, I don't trade pre-market. Not because there's anything wrong with it, but mostly because I wake up really early. I ain't waking up that early to get to the computer. You know, it's a sucker's game. That's a nerd's game to get to the computer at like 7 o'clock and be like, man, I'm trying to work on these muscles. I got none. I got none, man. I'm an Indian guy. You know, I got to be working out all the time. So, you know, when I wake up, I'm eating breakfast. I'm talking about people's, getting to work, but I'm not ready to do that type of work. You know, there's a long trading day ahead, and I don't want to be at that computer looking at stocks a minute before I need to, because the work that I do internally and externally plays more of an importance on my trading results than the amount of studying I do. Hey, Dimitri, a boot camp is not $5,000. I believe it's like $2,500 or so. And there's payment plans. So guys, remember, there's always payment plans for the boot camp. I think you can do like $475 for 6 months, or there's like $999 down, and you split it up. Gracie, how you doing, darling? Gracie asks, when do you do your scanning? I do mine at night. That's more my particular thing. I don't like to be rushed in the morning. Like, I don't want to get the computer really, really early and start doing my scans. I want to have my game plan ready before I get to the computer from the night before, and it's already on my, you know, it's on my platform, and I've got like this thing, and then I have to make slight adjustments. That way I'm not feeling rushed. You know, yeah, I gotta make some slight adjustments because the market's doing this or that, and I can add one or two stocks or take away one or two stocks. But it's not a full-blown build. Hey, Mr. Bradley, anytime, baby. Thank you. You know, I don't trade this TLT as it doesn't move that much, but, you know, it does seem like it's coming out of range. But, you know, once again, I'm not like a currency trader or bond trader. You know, to me, this is not anything in my wheelhouse. As a chart, like if it was a stock, I would just say it looks like it's getting ready to make a move. It's already starting to make a move. But, you know, you've got some levels there that are pretty clear. So, you know, I can't expertly say this is a good thing or a bad thing, but I would say you're getting close to that inflection point where you can get some movement. Sean's saying, would you recommend trading with a margin account? Sean, you know, trading with a margin account is like a big no-no, but I trade with margin. You know, most of my students trade with margin. Margin is more a matter of skill level. If you have the skills to make money, then trade on margin. If you suck and you're losing money, then you trade on margin, you're just going to lose more money because your gains get exasperated. Exasperated? I feel like you're saying exasperated is really dirty. Sounds almost like masturbated. Exasperated. You know, trading on margin when you stink is going to enhance your losses and enhance your gains if you're good. Hey, Gracie, where I find my stocks is I use TC2000. You know, I have like some scanners and some set watch lists and stuff that I like, whether it's biotech, it doesn't matter if it's biotech or, you know, whatever it might be. You know, so I have some different scanners, rubber band, you know, whatever it might be. So I use this as my primary tool. I like to beat my meat. Yeah, I mean, meat had a 50-day moving average kind of bounce. So yeah, I mean, that was a potential bounce zone. It's not an ideal type of play, but not bad. Is FinViz a good tool? Yeah, you know, I've used FinViz before. Not my cup of tea. I like TC2000, but it's pretty good. I've used it. Anybody else? Speak now or forever hold your peace. All right. Anybody? Hey, Kim, I will try to make my way to Brazil. I will. Folks, it has been real. If you guys got Any stupid questions, email Mary Beth. If you got any good questions, email me. I love questions. You guys can email me anytime. Mind you, there's probably 1,000 people in this webinar, so it may take me a second. But email Mary Beth if it's really, really important. If you don't mind me taking my sweet time, email me. I love talking about stocks. I know nothing, and I just warn you, I know nothing about where the webinar is going to be, what the link is, what the YouTube is, anything admin, I don't know. If you want to talk about stocks, I know. Guys, I love y'all. I'm going to try to do this again soon. Take care. Adios, muchachos. Folks, it's about that time. Going once. Going twice. Adios, muchachos! Adios, chayos!